You know, this is the cleanest and nicest police car I've ever been in my life. This thing's nice in my apartment.
Computer, I want you to shut down all the lens flare generators.
Lens flare generators deactivated.
Fascinating.
That's better.
I was unaware that we had that.
It's nice, right? I mean, who designs a starship where lights shine right in your eyes from
this?
Virtually every angle?
Sweet and low?
No. This is not sweet and low, this is equal. Blue packet. Sweet and low is pink. See? Equal blue, sweet and low pink. Not.
Aha! Darth Vader, if only you could be so bold. The Imperial Senate will not sit still for this. When they hear you've attacked a diplomat.
I know you have been inconvenienced, and I'm prepared to compensate you. Shall we say $1 million American dollars? Very well then, $2 million.
That is nice and Christmassy intro, isn't
a
it?
A deleted scene from something we may be talking about later.
Yeah, James Earl Jones messed up the lines a little bit, so.
We may or may not be talking about that movie a little bit later, because I'm Mark.
And I'm Tom.
And we are
the Cinemaniacs. Or perhaps the Santa Maniacs.
The Santa Maniacs.
I used to have an intro for that, but it's gone.
We did a Christmas show once.
We did.
Where we talked about Christmas movies.
That's right.
And I put that online for stations who run us in syndication, if you will, so they can run it any time because it's all old movies we're talking about.
Yeah.
And we actually do run it annually on Cheshire TV.
I didn't even know that.
We do. Because why not beat a dead horse farther into the ground? So, did you see anything this week?
I saw several things this
week.
Many things. In fact, I had a chance, unusually enough, to see everything that you arranged for us this week.
Woo!
It's hard to believe.
And I failed to see one or more things we'll be talking about later. But we'll talk about them anyway.
Yes.
Who should intro
I think you should probably start, because I have a feeling that I will be discussing the next one.
Okay. So, who are you going to call when an oppressive regime is taking over everything and everyone and everywhere in its path, and you are somebody who doesn't want to play those games? You don't want that kind of business. Well, if you are a ragtag band of misfit do-gooders, you hop aboard and set sail upon with which? Rogue One.
The next show will start in 4 minutes.
Save the cheerleader.
Yeah.
No, wait, sorry.
You know what's funny? On screen,
Ace Ventura
was funny.
I thought it was funny.
I saw that twice when it came out.
Really?
Locally. Maybe three times. What's funny is when you watch Rogue One, which is bandied about as Rogue One, a Star Wars story.
Right.
In case you didn't know, it's a Star Wars movie. The word Star Wars never appeared in this film on screen. Like, I expected the classic, you know, like with Empire and Jedi, how you
had
like a frame around the title that said Star Wars, and then in the middle, it says Rogue One. The font isn't even particularly a Star Wars font. There's no opening crawl. It's totally different from what we've seen before.
Yeah.
And even in the end credits, it never says, you know, Star Wars, never, which is kind of cool. I wonder how many people go into this movie knowing it's a new Star Wars movie who don't know where this takes place, this takes place.
That it's a prequel, I bet not a lot of them.
I mean, I was sitting in the theater with, you know, normal people, and I'm wondering, how many of these people don't know that this takes place before the original Star Wars?
Right. But one of the things that I was most impressed with, and then I'll let you continue before I jump in, was that this is a true standalone movie.
And
I thought that was very impressive.
I mean, it's standalone. It connects. You could edit this
and
Star Wars. If you cut out the opening credits and crawl to Star Wars, you could cut these movies together into one long movie.
Absolutely.
I mean, it is very seamless.
Although I think this looks better, strangely, for obvious reasons.
Yeah, this
is... 40 years later?
This is interesting. This was directed by the man who brought us the U.S. Godzilla, which I thought was not very good.
Yes,
and
I agree.
And an indie movie called Monsters, which I also didn't care for.
Oh, really? I like Monsters.
See, to me, I'm like, maybe a movie about a monster, if you call it Monsters. So, visually, very well done.
Yes.
Like, this movie feels real. They did something I love, which a lot of modern filmmakers are doing, which is you want an alien landscape, go to Iceland, go to New Zealand. You know that it's somewhere on Earth, but it's places you've never seen before. And that's what, like, the Bond movies used to give us way back when the world was a smaller or bigger, the world was a bigger place, and you'd see exotic locales and go, wow. So it opens on this, you know, damp planet where the main character is a little girl, and Mads Mikkelsen, who's the bad guy, is or not the bad guy. He's always a bad guy, so I just
right.
just fell out of my mouth. He's a bad guy. He plays her father in this, and he's a guy who's connected to the Empire in some way. And he thought he was out, but they pulled him back in,
yep.
Pacino-like. And just the landscape is amazing, and you get these sweeping shots of this landscape and these caves, and it's really cool.
But to interject, what I was struck with throughout the entire film, but at that particular moment, when some of the ships start to land and things, I believed it.
Yes.
This was the first time in all of the Star Wars movies that I saw this landscape, I saw these things, that these guys getting out, and I said, that looks so real. It was unbelievable.
This is the only Star Wars movie I've seen, and I've seen them all, that feels like it exists in a real world. And this does what, when we were kids, we always wanted like the Star Wars novels or comic books to do. You wanted to be able to, in theory, get in and walk around a little bit in the movie. And right. This is what it feels like. It takes place right before the original Star Wars. You could almost say simultaneous with it. It takes place a few weeks before the original Star Wars. And it's like you're able to go back in that world and look around a little bit, and it feels real. It doesn't feel like CGI characters and CGI green screen worlds like the prequels did. It's not overloaded with that at all. It feels like it's real people, real places, real scenarios. There's a gravity to it that the other ones don't always have. Certain aspects of this are clearly based on what has gone on in our real world in the last several decades. And the acting is very good for the most part. Yeah. Some of it is a little odd. There is the question as to whether Forrest Whitaker is playing Red Fox as Fred Sanford or not. It's possible, which is a funny tie back because Red Fox played Obi-Wan Kenobi in a Donnie and Marie sketch in the 70s that actually led to the Star Wars Holiday Special.
So well, that's too bad.
There's that going for it. Speaking of lost chapters. So what is the story of this movie? I'm not going to tell you. The story of this movie is a group of rebels try to steal the plans to the Death Star to get it back to the major rebellion so that they can do what they do in Star Wars, basically.
Right.
So it's a prequel. I hate prequels. I think they're a cowardly way to go with the story because you can't really impact anything, and it's always lame. But this might be the best prequel I've ever seen because it is a compelling and exciting story in and of itself that it doesn't matter where the final movie ends up because, with the Star Wars prequels, it's like, nothing bad can happen to this guy because
right.
he has to be in two movies from now. Or, the events have to lead to this certain thing. You go into this knowing how it's going to end, but the journey is what's worth it. Especially notable in the cast is Donnie Yen, Hong Kong actor, who we've reviewed some of his films, not in English. He's amazing in this. He's basically Zatoichi. He's like a blind martial artist.
Yeah, he's the Zen Jedi.
And he's really funny, and when he busts out the foo, dear God, they shoot it so you can see it. There's a couple moments where he's doing some things to people and you're looking at him from behind while he's walking away from the camera, and I'm thinking, that's a very odd way to present this. But otherwise, standard wide shot,
right.
Oh my God, it's exciting. And he got the major laugh in the film that
yep.
I heard from the audience that I saw it with. Is this a movie for kids? Maybe not really.
For
it's
real
pretty
little
dark
kids,
and violent.
Yeah, it can get pretty.
There's a lot of wholesale slaughter. In
there's
this
certainly
movie.
Not blood or anything. But it's Star Wars-y sci-fi violence, but there's a lot of action going on. Eventually, my major complaint is I found the first hour boring as all get out. I didn't fall asleep, but just snooze boring because it was all this backstory about these characters. I don't care. Get on with it. Once we finally got on with it, about an hour into it, it picked up and I started to enjoy it.
Now,
so overall, I'm a thumbs up on it. First hour, I sure could have done with that.
It might be because you texted me the word boring
yes.
after you saw it before I did, that I was prepared for some slowness.
Okay.
But it never bothered me. Like this could have been longer as far as I was concerned. It was just, I just was so into it. And I was a huge Star Wars fan when I was a little kid.
Sure.
And that's something that I've kind of left back there. Like, I don't rewatch the movies. To me, they're big screen things. Like, I don't want to see Star Wars on anything smaller than a movie screen. And I don't, read the novels and all that other stuff. It's a fond memory, and I see the new ones when they come out. And this, certainly more than The Force Awakens and maybe the prequels, has re-sparked an excitement for Star Wars for me.
Well, we know we're going to get Solo, no pun intended,
yeah,
Solo Han Solo
a
movie.
Solo adventure.
And we'll probably see some other ones coming out.
I think, it's funny, on my Facebook memories popped up the day I went to go see
really?
Rogue One, it popped up a photo I had posted of waiting in a long line at Keen Cinemas to see The Force Awakens on opening night. So I think if they're pumping out a Star Wars movie a year,
right,
alternating between continuing the story and then maybe filling in the cracks, that's going to be a really smart marketing plan. And if they can keep them up to this level of quality,
right,
golly gosh, that's going to be pretty good. I'll stop talking now so you can share your thoughts with us.
Little else to say. I was very disappointed in the first hour relative to action. Because I thought, I did think performances were terrific. I thought the production design was just spectacular. What do you expect? But as you had said, more than any other science fiction film period I've ever seen, I could believe this world. Blade Runner might touch on it, but I just thought that was terrific and fun to look at. Performances were great. And once we eventually got underway with some of the action, and I'm not needing Fast and Furious constantly. That's one of the things I dislike most about the most recent Star Trek, which I think you like more than I did.
It's an action movie.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That once it got underway, we have lots of fun characters. You talked about our blind Zen Jedi.
And the female lead is outstanding. She's wonderful. A great actress anyway.
Yeah, but. And she clearly takes over the screen whenever she's on. She's got kind of a romantic love interest alongside, and he doesn't begin to hold.
I love that they didn't even get to that.
Right, yeah,
until right at the end. Because I hate when every movie, it's a male and female. Of course, it's a love story.
Kiss her and get it over with.
They didn't really do that.
Yeah. But she just outshines him every moment, every possible moment. So she's terrific. They have a robot, a big tall robot who is all lanky, and he's some fun comedy relief. So I was really impressed. About halfway through, it really started going on all cylinders, and this was the Star Wars I was expecting. So overall, I really enjoyed it, I think.
And with our opinions, now it's going to start making money.
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm sure that'll be the case.
So you have something to talk about.
Well, speaking
that I didn't
of making
see.
Money, Edward Norton and Will Smith are really good at making money because they're heads of an advertising, they're executives and owners of an advertising firm that is just doing super well. They're hiring all sorts of people. The holidays are coming along. And Will Smith has a tragedy occur in his life. He loses his six-year-old girl. And we pick up the story 3 years later. We see that at the very beginning. 3 years later, things are just going downhill, and his three friends and business associates, Edward Norton, Michael Pena, and Kate Winslet, really need to help things out, and they want to field an offer to sell it, but Will Smith won't deal with it because he's having to deal with the death of his daughter and the collateral beauty. Oh, so they almost said collateral beauty in there. So we've talked about, usually at the end of the year, we'll either do not best and worst, but maybe our favorites and the ones that disappointed us the most. And I'd already been compiling both of those. And I had to make room. I had to move Kubo and Hell or High Water down because this is by far my favorite movie of the year.
Wow.
Just wonderful. I mean, terrific performances from everybody. Helen Mirren, I'll stand in line and see anything she does. Keira Knightley, Michael Pena, Edward Norton is great. Will Smith. Will Smith doesn't say a word for the first half hour or 45 minutes because he's that pulled out of it. He's that torn apart with the death of his daughter. And that's what sparks all of this. His business associates, played by Winslet, Pena, and Norton, and they really sell this. This is what I thought was so wonderful. And this is both a tribute to the writing and the directing and the acting, I think, that what they have to try to do is they follow him around. As we heard in that trailer, what Will Smith is doing as kind of a therapeutic thing is he's writing notes to death, love, and time and saying, you know, love, you just tore my heart out and I'll never live with you, blah, 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 blah. And so he does that therapeutically. His friends find out about that, and so they say they try to mount a campaign to have him declared incompetent because he owns, through various reasons, he owns 60%, a controlling share of the company. So if they want to sell it and try to salvage their business and for these hundreds of people that are working for them, they have to do it. So I really bought that. The three of them were saying, we feel so awful about this, and this isn't about money. And they actually, this trailer initially kind of misleads you, I think. And minor spoiler alert, I'll do this if you want to turn it off and come back when I tell you to do this. So minor spoiler alert, I'm going to get a little bit into the plot. The trailer makes it appear that Mirren and I'm not sure who the young actor who plays Time is, but Mirren and Keira Knightley and this other young black actor who plays Time are the actual Fates. And so I was a little disappointed, and my son Walter and I went to see this. We were, unfortunately, the only ones in the theater. And it starts out that Will Smith's three friends, Norton, Peña, and Winslet, actually Norton sees Keira Knightley auditioning for a commercial. And she takes off. She gives him some suggestions. She takes off, and he follows her to a stage where he meets the three of them and their actors. And so they hire them to play these roles. You can come on back if you want to come on back. So that was a little disappointing. But there's some fun little twists, fun little surprises that occur here. Overall, I'm as I tend to do with films that I really, really like and that are really well done, I get overly picky. And so there are a few lines toward the end that are a little pushy. And the way they try to, the way they hire somebody to follow Will Smith as he's talking to these people and digitally remove these people who he's talking to, and the technology, Lucas would have to do that, and it'd have to be formally staged. So I think most of the time, people like us are the only ones who would pick up on that. I think you could have gotten around that, and this could have been. For me, it's a 9 out of 10. I just really, really loved it. Could have been even that much better. But overall, it's a wonderful time for the holidays. It's tear-jerky every moment. There's a wonderful subplot between Will Smith and this woman who is running a grief counseling service that he stands outside and looks at and eventually goes into. So all sorts of little ties and everything that come together really made Collateral Beauty certainly my favorite movie of the holiday and I think of the year. You'll definitely be hearing me talk about it if and when we do our favorites.
So this is counter-programming for people who don't want to see a space opera
right,
and
yeah,
lasers
probably.
And shoot 'em up.
Yeah, and unfortunately, I think it is too bad that this comes out opposite Star Wars. And I hope it sticks around, and I really do encourage folks to go see it because I just thought it was wonderful.
I bet it will be locally at Keen Cinemas for at least another
week. I can hope so. I want to see it again.
I think it's rare. You know, someday I would like to have... When the dust settles, the owner of
yes.
Keen Cinemas on camera to talk about
he
this.
He said the first thing I talked to him,
yeah.
He said, you know, I'm a great guy to come and interview. I said, we'd love to talk to
because
you.
Because I wish more people, more of the public would understand how it all works. And I've always wanted to do that. Part of it is when a theater gets a movie, they're usually, in order to get it, they have to commit to playing it for X number of weeks.
Right.
So it is usually a guarantee that any movie is going to usually be somewhere about 2 weeks if you're talking about a multiplex. So again, as we are fond of saying, if you're interested in this film, you probably should see it sooner than later.
Yep.
Because like 4 movies come out next week.
Yeah.
This weekend because of the holiday weekend. So speaking of life-changing events.
Yes.
Here we have a documentary, new documentary, that tells the tale, true life tale, of many lives that were forever changed in the shadow of the tower.
Yes?
Light and cheery.
Right.
Merry Christmas.
Happy holidays.
And happy holidays.
Right.
So this is the documentary about the infamous University of Texas, I believe, Austin, sniper that happened in the late 60s. This guy, whose name, why bother saying this dirtbag's
right,
name,
yeah.
really? Who decided to, he killed his family and then he went onto this tower and he was just picking people off until he was stopped. This film focuses on the people who were there, survivors of that event. Survivors both in terms of they may have been shot and they survived and they're still alive to tell about it because
right.
it's been like 40 years now. Or 50, close to. So it's very interesting. It's predominantly animated.
Mm-hmm.
There is some stock footage and actual news footage of the day that is used and audio recordings of the day. The animation is sort of a rotoscope style. It reminds me of a Waking Life. And I mean, Ralph Bakshi was doing rotoscoping way back. I mean, hell, Max Fleischer was doing rotoscoping. But they have contemporary actors both reenacting the events and sort of doing on-camera interviews. which threw me at first because I'm like, well, this isn't the actual person talking because they're a young person.
Took a little
talking,
getting used to.
But they were good enough actors that it didn't seem like a cheesy reenactment of somebody else's voice. Now, as it goes on in the movie, eventually they cut to the person who original person now speaking. So you see what you hear their own words. Obviously, they recorded all of these interviews with the survivors, and then they had the actors sort of reenact the dialogue and the statements that they were doing. I really liked, at first, the animation style I thought I wouldn't like, because in general I don't like that style of animation. But then I saw the purpose that it served for this, in that it, if these were just filmed reenactments, they would be cheesy.
Right.
Reenactments are always cheesy. But doing it animated, it allows you to turn the clock back as much as you want to that year and that era. And also, it creates a little bit of a distance. So I quite thought the animation worked really well. And it was a little creepy at times. And it's a very somber tone to this thing overall. Like the music, the incident, they don't focus at all on the shooter. So for the audience, the shooter is what he was for the people on that day. He is this invisible angel of death who you don't know where he is. You don't know why he's doing it. It's just a matter of trying to survive until somebody puts a stop to it. And you hear from a woman who was on the ground, laying on the ground, not knowing if she was ever going to get up again. People who were bystanders who tried to help. Police, you know, basically every angle except the bad guy. And eventually you see them in the modern day reflecting upon these things. But a lot of it is sort of told, it sort of unfolds, I don't want to say in real time because it was a few hours that this unfurled over. But I thought this was really good. This was not a happy film at all. It was very depressing and creepy and moving and really, really effective. And I would highly recommend it to anybody who knows of this incident because it really puts you there. Or anybody who wants to know. I mean, this is one of those things where now things like this are marketed as, it was the first mass shooter we ever had. Great. A lot of things do that. Like they will market a Lizzie Borden movie about, it was the first celebrity murder trial. Okay, great. But let's not make that like it's a good thing. So I thought Tower was really, really good.
I agree. I don't necessarily think it's certainly of interest to people who are familiar with the story. I think anybody, you know, it's hard to say you're interested in the topic
because it is such a shooting fan.
Right, exactly. Yeah. It is such kind of a somber, gruesome topic. But I think it's very informative. It sets everything up. And while I got a little tired of the amount of footage that was animated that we saw, I don't know what else I wanted them to do, but I just got a little tired of seeing that. I thought you refer to it as a rotoscopic effect. I thought the kind of almost unnatural, unrealistic animation, because it's very different than pretty much any other animation we see normally
today. Fluidity added, to it.
Yeah, added for me to the drama of it, to the gravity of the situation. I thought this was very uniquely done. You'd mentioned off air that we're probably going to see this at the Oscars, and I think it's, I'll agree and also say that I think it's worthy of that. I thought its approach to the topic was you know, hard to say refreshing, but very interesting. And I thought this was a really well-made film.
Could it unseat Pixar for best animated
feature? Well, watch out. That'd be hard to do, but yeah.
That'd be sad.
Take a breath,
No Singing
Academy.
Fish this year. A Sniper's Tale.
Right.
This is in theaters now. I think it is still relatively limited release, but I think it'll probably hang around for a while. Certainly, if the nominations come out, I'm sure you'll see this closer to home than it is currently for us here. That's all we saw in theaters this week.
Well, something that is close to home, depending on how you get it. If you're on a plane and there aren't snakes, for some reason Snakes on a Plane, it's been on the pay channels all over the place. And I won't say the typical line because it's not after 10. But if you're on a plane and things are going down, you want to make sure that your cast, your crew, and everybody else really has their heads about them. The best thing that could possibly happen to you would be if your captain's name was Sully.
What's this, a synonym?
I think it's a spice that you put on porridge.
Oh, porridge.
This plot's a little far-fetched.
Yeah, come on, I can't believe that, yeah.
It's a true story. it's fascinating, then. It's always odd to see movies that are ripped from the headlines. A friend of mine was saying, I don't want to go see a movie about something I still clearly remember from the news 2 years ago. This gets inside the event itself.
I had that very approach and was pleasantly surprised.
The idea, the basic plot of this movie is Captain Sullenberg. Sullenberg? Burger?
Something like that.
Sully.
Sorry, Sully.
Sully is sitting down and having to defend his actions and whether it was necessary to land on the Hudson, or whether they could have landed. And there are all these analysis going on, and it's basically, did these people do the right thing and follow procedure, or should they be reprimanded for what they did?
Right.
And
something I didn't know when all of that was going on.
Yeah, I never heard anything about that. And, you know, again, I'm a true story. We are presuming this all happened.
Right.
We know that he landed a plane on the Hudson and everybody lit.
There are certain people that I will trust, and Hanks is one of them, and Eastwood is the other one.
Yeah.
So I have to kind of believe that a lot of this is awfully true.
It's rare for Clint Eastwood to make a movie that is not entertaining and interesting.
Right. And phenomenally character-driven.
Oh, absolutely. And at its core, this is a movie that celebrates hardworking people doing their jobs. People who know how to do their jobs, just doing their jobs.
I want to interject real briefly so I don't forget it. There was one moment where after the plane has landed, that there's a call in to, I think it's the Coast Guard.
Yeah, or the Harbor Patrol.
The Harbor Patrol or something like that. And for some reason, this will always stick with me. Two or three of these guys just, there's no question in their mind. They instantly rush out, risking their lives, to instantly go out and help these people. And that almost brought tears to my eyes.
That was very effective. That section of the movie where you see, and it's obviously a tribute to the emergency mm-hmm. service workers in New York City, because you see that. You see the police and the fire department and everybody just jumping right into it, and everybody is being pulled out of the water, and it's all, you know, we got it from here, don't worry about it, blankets, boom. Everything was just, you know, a crack squad of people who are trained for this, and they're just employing the skills that
and
they
we're
have.
Clearly remembering 9/11 when all of this is going on as well, too.
Yeah. So I thought this was good. I mean, it's pretty low-key. It's a lot of flashing back and forth between the incident and being interrogated about the incident. And it's Tom Hanks, you know, as a good guy. What terrible casting. Tom Hanks is a good guy you trust. And it's a really strong drama overall. Not one for kids, just because I think they'd be bored. But if you want to show kids a movie that says, if you work hard and stick to your guns, you can make a difference in this world, Sully might be one of them.
I think that's ultimately, I initially thought when that was over, well, yeah, but what's the point? And I think the point is good people persevere. And you're right, who better to play just the average good guy than Tom Hanks? I too was very surprised. I went into this thinking, so they land a plane and what's the big deal? But that's not at all what this is about. This is about all of the media coverage and all of the internal FAA investigation and how it affects Sully. I was surprised Aaron Eckhart is wonderful as, and he plays a surprisingly large role in my opinion, as the co-pilot. And how the two of them work together in the plane, outside, and to support each other. I thought he was very good. So this took an unusual turn for me that I wasn't expecting, looking at the internals, at the people surrounding the crash, and as you quite rightly bring about, all of the people who come to their aid. I thought it was really impressive. If there's a complaint, one of my favorite actresses, Laura Linney, is in this, and all she is she's on the telephone.
She literally phones it in.
Yeah, what a boring way to portray this. And I know, and she plays Sully's wife, and so there's that communication back and forth, and there's emotionally gripping moments for them. But I was just thinking, boy, couldn't we make? I don't know how we could have played with it. You know, you could have brought her to New York. Okay, maybe it wasn't realistic, but I was just kind of disappointed that this was what I saw of Laura Linney. That's really kind of overall my only complaint with it. I thought it was a surprisingly heartfelt film and was very good. A nice, pleasant surprise.
Speaking of pleasant,
yes,
you say you like people getting shot. you say you like people getting shot. Just a whole lot of gunshots. We have a remake of a classic 60s film that is a remake of a classic 60s Japanese film. We have an all-star cast led by Denzel Washington and Chris Pratt, amongst others, and they are portraying, in this fine example of a film that is more than 90 minutes long, The Magnificent Seven.
So refreshingly different, the other soft drinks never had it. Ha ha ha, never will.
Okay, so I'll pay to watch Denzel Washington read his laundry list. But really, why was this remade? I just thought this was, I like Pratt, and Washington is probably the greatest actor alive today. And I just thought he was wasted, and why did it need to be remade? Sure, if you haven't seen any of the other ones, yeah, that's what it's got to be about. You know, it looked fine. The action was viewable, but I just not real fond of this version of the Magnificent Seven.
I went into this not remembering the original very well, other than that it existed.
Seven Samurai or the original Magnificent Seven?
The original Magnificent Seven. Okay. We didn't get into it. We got into this when we talked about this the last time. For everybody who was upset that they were remaking the Magnificent Seven was a remake of the Seven Samurai.
Right.
So before you get too upset. And there have been many other Magnificent Seven. There was a Magnificent Seven ride. There's at least two sequels to the 60s Magnificent Seven.
Yep.
I think there was a TV series at some point. So the brand has been watered down, but like all remakes, everybody forgot about everything except the original, which will happen with this too. I quite liked this. I didn't go in comparing it at all because I had a vague memory of the original. I just thought this was a fun crackerjack shoot 'em up. Oh, there's a lot of people who get shot in this movie.
Not, once again, it's like Star Wars. It's not bloody. I don't recall this being bloody, but boy, there's a lot of explosions going on.
When the people get shot, they don't get back up. So
right.
It's not like, ow. It's more like, ooh, you're, you're very quiet and still right now. I had a lot of fun. A lot of this toward the last act of the film is setting up all of a small number of people, setting up all of these little traps and things that they're going to utilize to take down a large number of people. So I think, as I said when it came out, if you want to see a small number of people killing a large number of people, this is the film for you.
I'll probably rewatch this because I like everybody in it, but I distinctly recall that moment. You know, the first two-thirds of the film builds up to the last third, which is this huge fight and all of these tricks and everything that they're setting up. And I remember having real geography problems with who's where and what's happening where and where are these things that are laid underneath the ground and who's going which direction.
That is
so
the curse of modern cinema.
Yeah, I remember it being very confusing.
I don't recall having that problem, and it might be just that there was enough that made me giggle and laugh
right.
I enjoyed that I did see that it overshadowed the poorly constructed stuff, which tends to be every movie these days.
And the reason I complained about it was I couldn't tell the good guys from the bad guys. So if somebody got killed, I was like, is that good or bad? I don't know what's happened.
See, the classic Bond films had it down pat. You got guys in orange jumpsuits killing guys in blue jumpsuits. All you need to know is what color you're rooting for, and you're all set.
Right.
So that is out on video, as well as, speaking of gunshot wounds and wholesale slaughter.
Right. Well, and more so than that, we'll tie all sorts of things together. In a futuristic setting, storks no longer deliver babies. They're just kind of, that's all been done. It's done by the wayside. So they're off working for UPS, I guess. They're delivering packages and everything for you. So at one point in time, when a baby needs to be delivered, nothing's available. And they have to recruit the help of those old birds. And you're going to have to call on at least one of those storks.
I don't mean to creep you out. That's mostly what I do. I'm watching and sucking.
This film is not yet rated. Okay. So to whom does this appeal? Or to whom is this aimed? At whom is this marketed? I'll keep working on prepositional phrases properly stated.
Bikers. It's bikers.
Yeah, I think, you know, really
bikers.
Tough drug addicts
and
recovering heroin addicts. No. Little kids, real little kids, new parents, I think. Other than that, one of the things that you and I usually try, at least what I seek in movies that are clearly aimed at the child audience, is there anything there for the adults? Or are you just paying dues by sitting through an hour and a half of this for something? There's enough there, I think. This isn't one of the better animated films. Is very pretty, lots of pretty colors. You'd like it for that. I liked it for that. But so Storks was innocuous enough. I think maybe it's one of those that if the trailer looks funny, you're going to get exactly what you expect. And you know, there's enough clever things there. The animation is interesting. Storks, not going to be on my top list, but certainly wasn't a huge waste of time. I think I'm going to put that on the box. Not a huge waste of time. That's a backhanded compliment.
When they're so desperate for a pull quote, it's
right,
like,
exactly.
Well, he didn't
Sorry.
Say he didn't like it.
Right.
Sorry. Not huge. So, speaking of films that are suitable for everyone
in the
family,
whole family,
for the entire age range this holiday season.
Yeah, looking for a nice Christmas gift?
The Arrow Video Corner presents a box set, a trilogy, if you will, of films inspired by the writings of one Mr. Clive Barker. And here we have a set of three films. We're going to show you 1, 2, 3 trailers for the films enclosed in this box. And the box contains the films that are part of the series entitled Hellraiser.
Yes, he did.
Okay, if you still possess your lunch after watching all of that, if you haven't changed the channel. So these films, first Hellraiser was 85, 86,
I think
I want to
say. 85, yeah.
87, second Hellraiser, third Hellraiser, early 90s, 89, 90, 91, somewhere in there. First Hellraiser, very small film. It takes place mostly in a house, not a lot of special effects, pretty low budget. A lot about the ideas behind the whole concept of this puzzle box that is ancient, and when you open it up, it opens up the gateway to hell, more or less. And bad things happen to those who enter those walls. Second film continues the story of the survivor from the first film. She's at a sanitarium or something like that, or a hospital, where the guy who runs the place secretly has been investigating this box all these years. So he tries to open it up again. Second film had a much bigger budget than the first film did, so you have far better effects, and it just really opens that world up. You go into the hell of these movies, and you get to see that. It's very M.C. Escher-ish kind of thing going on. And then the third one is basically...
kind of full of itself.
It's kind of not very good.
Sorry.
the third one is, at the end of the second film, all of the Cenobites and the bad guys have turned into this sort of stone column sculpture type thing, which this guy has and winds up bringing back to life. And I believe Hellraiser 3, Hell on Earth is the idea.
Right.
So it unleashes Pinhead and the bad guys onto the New York City streets. So first Hellraiser, I think, is quite good. It is creepy. It is gruesome. It is a world we've never quite seen before. It's concepts that you'd never seen in horror before. It's almost like a horror. They're almost like sci-fi elephants.
Right.
There are sci-fi elephants in this film. They're flying elephants, and they were pink. Second film expands upon that world in a big way. And the third, it seems to contract. It was sort of a different production team. And I didn't really care for the third one very much.
Okay.
First one I like, second one I like, although I recently saw the original Hellraiser in a theater with an audience, and somebody was saying to another person that second one was legendarily bad and everybody hates it and it was the worst of the series, and I'm thinking, I always thought it was pretty good.
Yeah,
watching it again, I'm like,
preferred
I
the second one.
I like the second one better than the first one.
Yeah.
The third one was garbage, and apparently they've made 10 of these things. So I only thought they did 4, and then when I was doing research for today, I saw Hellraiser, like, they made 10. I'm like, really?
Yes, I didn't know.
They just kept
that.
Cranking them out on video. So it's Arrow Video, so obviously these are the best these movies have ever looked. These discs are loaded with extras. Each film comes on its own discs. It's a 4-disc set. Each has documentaries, interviews with everybody involved, TV spots, trailers, audio commentaries, multiple commentaries. And the fourth disc has a feature-length documentary about the film series all together on itself, and plus more extras. So this is totally loaded. I believe this is a limited edition box set, so it'll be out in probably 3,000 copies, and when those are gone. But I would say if you're a fan of the Hellraiser movies, as with anything Arrow does, this is the version to get, and you can throw away everything else you've had. If you've never seen them, boy, what an introduction. And arguably, these three are the only, if not one too many, Hellraiser movies you'll ever have to watch. Now, have you seen these in the theaters when they came out?
Oh, yeah. I definitely saw the first three. And I seem to remember the fourth one. I don't know if I saw it, which is why when you off air were saying that there were like 10 of them, I'm going, what? I thought there were like 4,
yeah,
maybe 5. I liked the first one primarily because of its unique take. It is somewhat sci-fi. In the Arrow extras to which you allude, and I actually spent last night watching the majority of the extras, the production people and the cast and crew, you know, talk about it being a love story, and
it's a sick love story.
Yeah, it's a sick love story, and they admit that. For me, Barker has always been really kind of very full of himself, very self-interested, and I, that was one of the things I was attracted as a horror fan to Hellraiser, because it was so unique, and these new evil characters were so different than anything that we'd seen. But it had a real gritty quality to it. The first one was very low budget, and strangely enough, this is where the Arrow treatment almost kind of ruins the experience for me. Now, if you haven't seen Hellraiser and you're a horror movie fan, I think you've got to see it. but I miss the kind of gritty, similar to Phantasm, I think, kind of. It is super slick and just the best imagery you're going to find on it. So it's a terrific looking film. I was, strangely enough, a little disappointed in the extras. Loaded with extras. All sorts of interviews. Now, I'm not in any way, shape, or form equating Hellraiser to, let's say, Vertigo. But if you were going to remaster Vertigo and you had the opportunity to interview everybody involved, who would you want to interview? I would say it would be Hitchcock. Clive Barker is nowhere to be seen on these extras. It's everybody saying, oh, Clive was such a genius and such a wonderful girl. And, well, where the heck is he? I did a little research. My understanding is that he's still alive. Why wasn't he on there? So the interviews that you get in the behind the scenes, you'll hear a lot of the same information. So relative to the extras, I was a little disappointed in that. They look great. There's loads and loads and loads of them. And as you say, if you're interested in the films, they've never looked better. So it was lots of fun to get back and appreciate the first one. And then, as you say, see this progression of these characters. The guys who play the Cenobites and who play Pinhead did talk about the fact that when they made this first one, they figured certainly it was a one-off. As they were finishing it up, I guess New World, who was their production company, they started hearing, oh, maybe there's a sequel. But nobody knew that it was going to be all about the crazy evil sinister characters like Pinhead, and that's what it was. So I thought I was pleasantly surprised.
So on that note of, crazy evil characters, we'll bid you adieu for 3 weeks, and when we'll come back, we'll talk the fastest you ever heard two grown men talk on TV.
Absolutely.
Until then, I'm Mark.
And I'm Tom. Happy New Year.